السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. It is very odd in this global setting that I am here in the early afternoon. Some of you are already maybe in the evening. And I think that we tend often to compliment ourselves, or at least the environment in which we live, that we are a global, we are accessible to everyone. But that is, of course, not true. There are many who remain outside. And actually, by far, the vast numbers of people remain excluded from these discourses, although it is done in their name and claimed to be their entitlement as of right. So for me, therefore, recently I have been very busy with a book which I call Decolonizing Human Rights, from state-centered enforcement to people-centered practice. And my claim is that the state is incapable of protecting human rights and is therefore should not be conceded the leadership role. And so long as human rights remain a function of international law, a function of international treaties, international organizations, then the state will continue to claim the primary role, although she may not, or it may not deliver anything in the name of that excuse my dryness, and therefore I need to sip water from time to time. Look, okay. I am from Sudan, and in the 60s of the last century, amazing, I have to say the previous century, I was a student at the University of Khartoum, was active in the human rights struggle of our little community in the broader context of Sudan. And unfortunately, I think that we have failed. The post-colonial generation of lawyers, of professionals, and so on, we have failed because as we speak today now, Sudan remains in extremely dangerous and frustrating stalemate. Massive demonstrations are on the streets of Khartoum and Omdurman. It's amazing that colleagues and allies of yesterday in the initiation of the revolution 2 years ago almost now are now on opposite sides, which is all good. So long as we remain committed to values of democratic transformation and the values of our culture of acceptance of the other and so on. So therefore, Ibn Rushd represents to me, and I was aware of the founding of this organization, and I think at the founding, I managed to be part of the conversation, that this is where we are, this is where we can be most effective. That is with organizations like this. But there is a paradox in this also, because the idea that the state does not really protect human rights, therefore we should look where? We should look to organizations where civil society agents and actors will behave and act in the name of human rights and so on. But their limitations, whether it is spatial or material or financial or intellectual, continue to limit the discourse of human rights to a tiny, tiny minority of people. I'm thinking of Africans, and I can imagine easily that I would say not more than 2 or 3% of the total population of the continent are really engaged in this discourse. And I would say the same about the Arab region or in other South Asia and other places. Not only that, but even those who are engaged, unfortunately, they tend to hijack the concept and the institutions and the norms of human rights in order to advance their own narrow interests and objectives. In a way, it's unavoidable because we all act according to our conviction and our understanding. But all I'm asking for is the modesty in doing so, that we should not assume that because we say these things are changing or have changed. To my mind, things have not changed and are unlikely to change. The only way that we can really advance the cause is to hand it back or to give a recede from the stage, global or regional or national, and enable people to act in their own name and voice. And again, even my claim to do that itself is a violation of the dignity and honor of human beings who are being co-opted by all sorts of actors. Yesterday was the 21st of October, which in Sudan is remembered with tremendous reverence and fondness, because it sort of takes us back to October 21 of 1964, when the people of Sudan rose and ousted the first military regime in Sudan. And it was, by the way, and I think of one of the earliest in the region. So Sudan was the first to become independent, the first to experience military coup, and the first, all sorts of disasters. But to me, these are disasters with a value, which is that the outcome is going to transform and establish the idea of protection of rights more firmly in the hands of those whose rights are most violated. And as I mentioned briefly earlier, that tremendous demonstrations. Of course, these days everybody says, they call it Muzahara al-Millioniya, that is the million people sort of demonstration. I don't know how much can we be precise about the size, but they are tremendously huge. The question is, and what next? Because you have been here before. We have been here before as recently as overthrowing the al-Bashir regime. And I think we are still here. And therefore, let's be modest about what we can do, and so on. I think my role in this, or my own personal conviction and mission, I would say, is to be brutally candid. I don't mean to offend, but I will call names and describe events and so on in a language or in a manner that might sound to some to be offensive and so on. The point is that I think here we go. I would locate all struggles for social justice, for national security or communal security, for fundamental rights, all of these and others, every struggle that we can imagine, struggle of women for their equal human dignity and rights, and so on, are in fact, by definition, located in power relations and neo-colonial power relations in particular. The term neo-colonial is to acknowledge the fact that the colonial is still with us. And I don't expect the colonial to go away on its own accord. It has to be driven out of our, not only our homes and our communities and resources, but also from our minds and hearts. Because I think that we remain colonized in our minds and hearts. And that the language we use, here I am speaking in Arabic, in English, from the United States to audiences who are primarily in Europe and Africa, but could be eventually expanding. But it is still, this is the language that, for Muslims, I would say that it is the most widely spoken language. So that although it is really difficult for me to accept that I have to speak in this language to be understood, if at all, that is, but also that there is no prospects for breaking out of this. That English is the most widely spoken language among Muslims of the world. If we think about it, we'll see that the Indian subcontinent, South Asia generally, Central Asia, Southeast Asia, all of these regions which are predominantly Muslim populations. Also, the language that they can communicate with internationally is English. But the point is that not to accept that as a fact of life, it's a product of history. There is a history behind the dominance of the English language and the lack of possibilities of communication about our religions, our cultures, our commitments to certain values like human rights without somehow translating into this language. And translation, of course, is always problematic because when I say something, like, for example, the term secular, that is obviously in at the core of this conversation. I say secular, and the book that I was published in 2008, Islam and the Secular State, the use of the term secular is to try to connote or to indicate a break of religious hegemony in the field, that people should be able to speak and to act and to implement their values, their commitments, and so on, not regardless of religion, because it will be really an illusion to think that we can escape it completely, but at least to know that this is where we are, that we are talking about this, that even when I say the secular, because the secular is understood necessarily in contrast to the so-called religious, which assume that there is a religious and there is a secular. And the irony is, of course, I don't have to interpret or to elaborate on either of those two terms without missing something or losing something with the audience that I'm trying to communicate. So this idea that we are here still suffering from the consequences of colonialism is really something that we have to remember constantly. Almost 2-3 weeks ago, I sent the final sort of review of a book I'm publishing. It's called Decolonizing Human Rights. I mentioned this before, maybe. And the point for me is that, yes, we are in a state of colonization, and we need to liberate our understanding of human rights, our practice of human rights, out of this colonial condition into a genuine liberation of our hearts and minds. And that the nature of the power relation that control the field globally, going back to 1948, 45, and probably for the last century or so, is that it is deeply and structurally colonial. The point about human rights in particular is to understand that the environment in which human rights was so-called defined was a colonial environment. And when I grew up in Sudan, went to law school in Khartoum, and then traveled and studied abroad, going back all the way to the 60s, I thought that all I have to do is confront certain issues about Sharia in order to be able to realize the glorious vision of human rights. But over time, I have come to realize that it is, in fact, both sides of the equation. I have to confront things about Sharia, but also I have to confront things about human rights. And in particular, the new colonial control and hegemony in the field. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights was published in Paris in 1948, and it was celebrated as something that the French Revolution, the American Revolution have really foretold and set the scene for, and all we have to do is just carry on from here. But of course, that was a naive vision, because France, which was celebrating its claim that it originated the idea of the rights of man and the citizen and so on, was in fact a colonial power, in particular in North Africa, and even specifically more in Algeria. And to think that France continued to colonize Algeria for 10 years until the early 1960s, while it was claiming to be one of the guardians of the human rights paradigm that was established in the United Nations, that is the level of the paradox. There are several paradoxes that I have in my notes, but that's definitely one of them, which is the reality that the powers that control the United Nations itself and the powers that control the development and implementation of international law are colonial powers, all of them. And they are still colonial powers. And they will never cease to be colonial powers unless we make it so. They are not going to concede and step back and say, oh, sorry, we are regretting what we have done so far and we are going to stand in the way. It's absolutely stunning that the United States and Britain would invade Iraq and kill thousands and hundreds of thousands of Iraqis in the first century, in the first decades of the 20th century, that the United States invaded and destroyed and killed hundreds of thousands of Afghans also in the name of, and by the way, it's absolutely amazing. The United States, at least in particular, there is no discussion whatsoever about the invasion and what justified it and whether there should be any accountability for it. The United States does not care for international law. It will act according to its own conviction about what its own national interest is. And then let the lawyers, let the others come and clean up after it. But there has never been, I have lived in the United States now 25 years, and I have been there a couple of times before. Not a single time did I see any accountability for human rights conduct of the United States. So I call it in this book that I mentioned, I call it the supreme hypocrisy of the United States. The so-called superpower that monitors the human rights conduct of every single state in the world except itself. The annual human rights report of the United States traces the human rights conduct of every state except itself, of course. And you wonder why should it claim that right in the first place? So all of these, as I said, are things that they are jarring, they are offensive, they are frustrating. And then we look around and see how geopolitics controls what sort of human rights priority is given to this and the other. That when we have the so-called refugee crisis in Europe over the last 2-3 years since the point about the war in Syria and before that the war in Iraq and Palestine, which remains forever sort of the site of see but do not touch. I mean that people know what's going on, but there is nothing they seem to be able to do. And really, with all due respect, I don't see how we can congratulate ourselves on subscribing to something that like the universality of human rights without confronting the reality of occupation and destruction and humiliation that Palestinians are suffering and continue to suffer. So I'm saying that the structure of international law that was somehow linked to the possibility of international protection of human rights is really flawed, fundamentally flawed, because international law is not really an instrument of protection of rights, because it is an exclusively interstate institution. Human beings have no space, have no location, have no resources to bring issues to the realm of international human rights law on their own, independent of the major powers and their choices. And when the major powers continue, it's absolutely stunning that Britain was the last colonial power over Iraq. The United States is the first colonial power over Iraq in the 21st century. And the two came and they did all they chose to do. And they went back home celebrating, some of them, foolishly, I would say, what they have done without any mention of accountability. Without any mention of the accountability should be international, it should not be national. Because the nature of international law is supposed to be international. It is universal. So where is the universal accountability that any of the powers, of the colonial powers and others who are now in the same field, can we find or see? Of course, I mean, I can continue to lament the issues that seem to sort of frustrate our values and so on. But let me move on to conclude more specifically, because I'm a Muslim from Sudan. And when I started working on human rights issues in the 1960s, I'm not working in the grand sense, but simply being part of the students' voices that were rising in the field, the question of Sharia was the problem. In our view, that if only we could control the role of Sharia in public life, we can have a glorious future as independent, democratic, and so on. But of course, Sharia, yes, it is fundamentally flawed in relation with the paradigm of human rights, as I will briefly try to explain. But so is the so-called United Nations or international human rights system. It is equally flawed. And it is equally relativist. This point, again, I mean, I've traveled many times, I've defended myself, the idea of relativism, cultural relativism, and how it is applicable to Muslims and this and that. But of course, I am also now aware that I was too naive in my conversations, in my critique, because I should have been able to uphold the same charge wherever it lies. And that, of course, that in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the system that followed from it, cultural, what I call liberal relativism, is dominant. So any conception of human rights is relativist. There is no way of avoiding the relativism of any concept, because whether it is me or you or any other body else, is that it is our relative, our limited vision and possibilities of liberation that we see that controls how much we can expect the international human rights system to deliver. There is a very troubling feature, I think, which is the way that the Charter of the United Nations was drafted in a way that the five permanent members of the Security Council effectively control what the United Nations and the so-called international community can do about the protection of human rights anywhere. Even the idea of state, of just simply freedom from so-called colonial rule and administration, so on, is controlled by those five powers. Any one of them could choose to cast a veto against a Security Council resolution that would call for any member of the international community, so-called, to be admitted into the United Nations. So in other words, I'm sure that the lawyers in our group would be clear of this, but also others, as in political scientists and so on, will be aware of it. That the point is that membership of the United Nations is achieved by a decision of the General Assembly on the recommendation of the Security Council. So if the Security Council refuses to recommend, no state can make it to the floor of the General Assembly to be voted on as a member of the United Nations. And membership is crucial for ability to, because it's membership of the international community. The ability to conclude treaties, to negotiate all sorts of relief and so on, to provide sort of some measure of protection for some human rights somewhere. So we see that it is whenever we turn to a more radical, a more fundamental charge against the new colonials, against the sort of the obvious continued manipulation and control of our international institutions, we are locked out. And we remain out until those who colonized us for centuries decide to admit us in, and you wonder why, to what end, and so on, because they never give up their control of the point. So the struggle for me was it took me time, I admit that. You know, initially I was just simply, oh yeah, all you need to do is just focus on these questions about Sharia, and then the rest will be fine. And it's only for decades later that I realized that my view was very partial and very limited. So here I think I'm sort of throwing remarks that I hope maybe in the question and answer I can further elaborate or explain, but that the subject itself is riddled with contradictions and paradox. Islam, I mean, we tend to talk about Islam, tend to talk about Sharia. If you talk about Sharia, then you cannot talk about human rights in the same breath. Sharia, as a historical understanding by Muslims of what Islamic so-called law is supposed to be, does not acknowledge the possibility of equality of human beings. So, and you wonder, I mean, we need to clarify and challenge and conduct and educate actually our own communities to realize what they're saying and what they're doing. The demonstrations in Khartoum that I mentioned at the beginning of this talk are about whether Sharia should be the law of the land or not, or whether Islam should be the instrument of politics and so on in Sudan. After 30 years of utter cruelty and barbarity and atrocious crimes committed throughout the country for 30 years, and still we are talking about that. So, point to put forward, whatever you think of Sharia, we cannot, it is incompatible with human rights, period. But we cannot go any further without fundamentally challenging the claim of Sharia or the claim of those who promote so-called Sharia to provide for sort of liberation instrument and institutions that Muslims from all over the world can really hope to achieve, a protection of human rights and so on. In other words, that you have to put Sharia as historically understood out to be able to talk about the rest. Fundamentally, women cannot be equal to men. Fundamentally, non-Muslims cannot be equal to Muslims. And so on. So it is integral. It is not something that you can sort of eliminate and put aside and the rest will remain. Any understanding of Islam is completely bogged down on this issue. But that is not the only story, because as I said also that the human rights paradigm is also problematic because it claims to be universal by virtue of its adoption at the United Nations in 1948, Universal Declaration, and subsequent treaties. But we know that the international organization that adopted and proclaimed the Universal Declaration itself was not international. And it was not universal. There were only 40 members, 50 members of the United Nations at the time. And only from, if you look at Africa, only 4 African states were members of the United Nations when the United Nations General Assembly voted to adopt the Universal Declaration. And of course, it's not a treaty. I take it that we are aware of this, that it is just simply a declaration. And subsequently, when we get really almost seduced by the language, it's a very powerful, it's a very powerful vision. And for the life of me, I would love to be able to speak it with a sense of honesty and conviction, as I have come to know its limitations and to know the real sort of agenda behind adopting the Universal Declaration. It is not universal. Only African, four African states, as I said, were members, and those were South Africa, Ethiopia, Liberia, and I can't block on the fourth one. So it is Egypt. Yeah, sorry. So none of those was really an independent state in itself, or capable of protecting human rights in its own communities, and yet that was the only African voice that was present at the United Nations. And you go on, I mean, you continue, and you will see that all this business about reservations to treaties, that whatever treaties are adopted, any member of that state, member of that treaty, can enter any reservations. And of course, technically, international lawyers will huddle down and look and see, oh, but this language and that language, Germany can object to the Arab states which adopted the Convention on the Equality of Women. Yes, you can do that, but and then what happens? And it is so limited, it is so contradictory, because you are doing this at a time that you know that more fundamental questions are being overlooked and suppressed by that conversation. I hope I don't, is there someone who can remind me of the time and so on? So let me move on to say that, as I said earlier, the term secular is problematic because it is a contradistinction. I would like, and I would I'm happy to continue to struggle for that the state cannot be Islamic, but I cannot accept that immediately it means secular. You know that the counter distinction between the secular and the religious, assuming that Islam is a religion in the same way that Christianity is a religion, of course, which is not true. Historically not true, sort of theologically not true, and politically not true in every way. Therefore, I have to think of a way that in which I can define the relationship between Islam and the state that does not rely on the European experience with the secular state. Because it is European experience. It is not a universal experience as such. And again, I think that the shallow value of European acknowledgement of the secular state and secular human rights and so on was exposed really shamefully, really exposed during the so-called refugee crisis. When we say European states refusing to admit people, in reality, because they are Muslims. But without doing anything about the application of the principles that govern the refugee plight and movement and so on. So the term secular is problematic, as I said. I would like to mention briefly there's a very fun, I call it the theft of the century, or rather the confidence trick of the century. That is, since the Universal Declaration was adopted, European and other colonial powers, primarily European, I would say North Atlantic, the trick is simply that they proclaim their own national civil rights as universal human rights. In other words, that what the rights that were included in the Universal Declaration and subsequently in the covenants and in the treaties are all already adopted by European and North American powers out of their own national struggles. And I celebrate that. I congratulate them on the fact that at least within their boundaries, subject to their own national jurisdiction and so on, they are struggling with these questions and achieving some degree of success until we come to see something like what is going on in Texas today in relation to the rights of women to control their own bodies and their right to an abortion at any level of, even when it is the most dangerous and serious situation. So I know I'm just hitting so many balls, and I hope that you know what I mean when I say something like Texas or Georgia, where I live in the United States and so on. So, but the point is that no treaty can be adopted at the national level without the action of the national government of the country in question. And therefore, we have celebration and speed in adopting international human rights treaties that are already consistent with the national rights discourse of the country in question. But there is absolutely zero possibility of human rights being proclaimed despite or against the will of the West European North Atlantic type of states. And again, here you see that how the language is manipulated, that we keep talking about the universal rights, while in fact what we mean are national civil rights. And if you look closely, you will not see that it is ever more than that. And that, again, the lack of possibilities of enforcement anywhere. You know, I think that really those of us in the room who, or I would say in this system, who claim to be human rights advocates should really question ourselves into how can we sort of overlook the fact that the protection, refugees really are the primary, are the absolute, almost like idealistic notion of universality of human rights. Because all other violations, you know, like primarily civil and political rights of people who have to leave their country because for fear of political persecution and so on, that language that came out of the European Convention on the it was, of course, international rather than European, 1951, the Refugee Convention, and then subsequent instrument that went in that regard, are all focused on a liberal civil and political rights notion of human rights. And of course, it is not human rights if it's only limited to that, because human rights are the rights of the human, not the right of the citizen. The rights of the citizen are extremely important. There is also a protection of the language and the space in which people can struggle for their domestic civil rights and also seek to contribute to global struggle for human rights, truly and or correctly or appropriately understood. But in fact, when you look closely, no. Refugees are humiliated in the thousands and the millions. They are excluded, they are kept in miserable human living conditions. And yet we still are willing to go up by and say that, oh yes, we will try this and that and so on. But there is no really care for the underlying causes of the plight and flight of refugees. Why refugees have to leave their homeland in the first place? People talk about Syria, talk about Iraq, talk about Afghanistan. But in fact, when you look closely, who planted the seeds of those horrendous conditions for the Kurds, for the Shia in Iraq, for the Syrian minorities and religious groups, going all the way, anywhere you go. So therefore, there is no fundamental accountability to the root causes, which are all sort of traceable to colonialism and to colonial occupation. Unless we are willing to talk in those candid terms, and I should stop very soon now to listen to what you think of what I'm saying here. Therefore, the paradox is in the idea of universal human rights itself. Because if they are universal by virtue of their being accepted by every human being globally, that's not true. In fact, it is probably not true that even the majority of rights are acknowledged by, even if not fully accepted by all communities and people. It doesn't make it there, actually. When you think about looking to every region and see how far does the language go for it to be coherent and relevant to people who live in those communities, in regions of Africa or regions of South Asia and so on, you'll see that it's extremely limited. And then also that we tend to celebrate, you know the Human Rights Council in Geneva annually, this so-called annual review that states submit their reports and we did this and did that. But it's all about sort of nominal theoretical acknowledgement of rights in very glorious language, but in absolutely zero production of value, of experience of human beings. And look for it and see that all of them, they come and report that we adopted this statute, we adopted that policy, but what came out of it? And after decades, because it was the Human Rights Commission, became the Human Rights Council now, and it's doing this and that, but go back and see how much any of this have had an impact in the country in question, and that the conditions under which human rights continue to be violated in those communities, the international community so-called is a contributor to that, and it is extremely selective in highlighting certain types of violations and so on. So I am not giving up, and I'm grateful to Amani for noting my so-called pragmatic optimism. I'm not giving up on human rights, but I'm just simply challenging our inability to be honest with ourselves and acknowledge that nothing we are doing now is really truly in the service of human rights as universal values. And that we have to allow and accept that, rather than allow, I'm sorry, take allow back, to accept the right of people to define human rights as they see fit themselves. Nobody should be in a position to define what human rights are to me or for my people anywhere in the world. And for us to celebrate the fact that, the death penalty has been abolished in Europe, and that's a human rights advance. You know, was it Protocol 11, I think, or I'm sure the European lawyers would know. The thing is that when the Universal Declaration was adopted, when the Civil and Political Rights Covenant and others were adopted, there was no mention of prohibition of the death penalty, because European societies were still married to that idea and committed to that idea too much. It was too politically expensive for the European leaders to confront the death penalty in their own societies. Over time, those societies came to really acknowledge for themselves through their own conversations and struggles and references to their own values that the death penalty is really a violation of human rights. They adopted the protocol. But that's a European, not a universal instrument. And what is significant to me is that it did not make it to be an international, so-called, the claim of international human rights until European societies, for themselves, by themselves, decided to make it so. So you should not be going anywhere else in the world and telling people what to believe or not to believe about human rights. People should do that. You know, the people who are responsible are people like myself. That we are the ones who should be making the point to our communities and promoting this value, the notion of that the human being, by virtue of their humanity, is entitled to these rights. But what these rights are is open-ended. It should not and cannot be limited. Trade union rights. Whatever came of trade union rights in the world today? How come? Isn't that sort of some oversight from the Cold War? When that was relevant, people were struggling about this and the other. Now that we don't have a Cold War, a Cold War, they just simply let it slide. They don't be too candid or honest about this. In conclusion, my point is that Islam is not exhausted by Sharia. In fact, Sharia is a limited discourse among Muslims that came very late. It has no existence in the Quran or Hadith. It has no existence in Muslim discourse for centuries. And when it was, or to the extent that it was acknowledged, it was not acknowledged as a legal normative system. It was acknowledged as a value system or ethical system, but not as a legal in the sense of positive rights in the European tradition. And that it was only in the post-colonial. When we look at this and see that the term and the discourse of Pakistan, talk about Pakistan as an Islamic state, this is the 1930s, never before. And when it became so-called Islamic state in some discourse, it was rejected by other discourses, by Pakistani themselves, and that was not the way in which the country became independent. If and to the extent that it sought to be, that we should be very categorical that Pakistan is not an Islamic state. In fact, there is no such a thing as an Islamic state. Never has been, never can be. Never has been, never can be. Not from day one, since Abu Bakr became the caliph. And I come to this point because I know that in some minds, the question will be, how about the prophet? The prophet was a prophet. You cannot judge what other societies 1,000 years after can do or not do by a community in which the prophet was the source of what Islam is. So when the prophet said, this is Islam, it became, or women should have this or not that, and non-Muslim should this and that, that became Islam by virtue of the prophet telling us so. But since Abu Bakr, there has never been an Islamic state. Abu Bakr was not, Umar was not, Ali was not, all of them. Osman was not by far. And look at the Khawarij, and look at the sort of the Abbasids and their sort of takeover. And the sequence of imperial states across the Muslim world, none of them was Islamic state. In fact, the idea of an Islamic state itself is alien to them. Why should we worry about this? It should not be a priority. We should be categorical. Being Muslim does not require me to subscribe to the idea of an Islamic state or to support it. In fact, it is the opposite. That because if I insist on an idea of an Islamic state, the Islamic that's going to be imposed by that state has nothing to do with the Islamic that I accept as a value system for myself. So it is, in fact, as I say in Islam and the secular state, I need the state to be secular. And I hate having to use the term, as I explained earlier, but what can I do? I'm trying to use a language that is not mine anyway. But the point is that I cannot be a Muslim by conviction and choice unless the state is not real Islamic or religious. That is, if the state is so-called Islamic or religious, I am unable to be the Muslim I choose to be by conviction and choice. So what is the, why the worry, why the guilt that we know is futile and will not take us anywhere? I hope that I have not raised too many questions, and I should stop and see what people think of this.